Well, main stage, we're really excited about this. This evening, we have the distinct pleasure of welcoming Vanessa Diffenbaugh, best-selling author of Language of Flowers, and most recently, We Never Asked for Wings. Both of these beautiful stories introduce characters who are so poignantly portrayed that we, the reader, fall in love with them and are drawn into their lives and hardships and triumphs. Vanessa stands apart as an author who is keenly aware of the people who live around her and the unique needs of the disenfranchised and the struggling. Her stories make the reader want a better world for her characters and for those in our own community. She is joined on stage tonight by guest host Sarah Barrett-Neal. Sarah is a writer and a photographer. She may be familiar to you as a previous guest host on this stage and also the host of Talk About Books at the Glen Arbor Art Association, Talk About Art at the Glen Arbor Art Association, where during the winter series, she'll interview in a similar conversation a local artist and their process. She's also the manager of the Center Gallery in Glen Arbor. Please welcome with me Vanessa and Sarah.
Thanks. Do you like our flowers?
They're beautiful.
It's the language of flowers. Welcome to Northern Michigan.
Thank you so much for inviting me. I'm really happy to be here.
Let's dive right in.
All right, I'm ready.
Okay. We Never Asked for Wings is a story that's set in San Francisco. It touches on themes of family, immigration, how one grows into being a parent. So let's start by looking at two scenarios here.
Okay.
You said in the acknowledgement to this book, I'm quoting you, they say, book two is hard. I believed it to be true, so this book was hard for me, really hard. Okay, that's one scenario.
Okay.
The other one is, I read that as you wrote this book, you had your dog Buddy on your lap the whole time. What's so hard about writing a book when you got Buddy on your lap?
Well, first of all, I lived in Cambridge for 3 years, and I had the wonderful pleasure of meeting Lois Lowry right as I had just sold my first book, and I was very new to this. You know, prior to selling Language of Flowers, I'd been a stay-at-home mother of four, supporting my husband in his work as a high school principal, very focused on my family, and suddenly I was thrust out into the world. My book sold in 43 translations, and I went on tour for almost 2 years with my family. So I was overwhelmed just by the sudden change, like on a physical level. And I also had my youngest going off to full-day preschool, which was harder for me than for him, for sure. And I met Lois Lowry. She brought me into her home. She made me a cup of tea. And over the course of about the first hour, she made it very clear that the first thing I needed to do was get a dog. And I pretty much did everything that Lois Lowry ever told me to do. You know, over the years she would have me over, she introduced me to other women writers in Boston. She was such a great mentor to me. And every time I would go over, her dog would come and sit on my lap. And, you know, she was right. I would say things to her, you know, like very, very philosophical, intense questions about the writing process, and she would say, "Well, I think you probably just need to keep going." You know, she's just wonderful. She's very practical and smart, and you know, she's the kind of writer I really want to be.
That was a lucky break.
It was. It was incredibly lucky.
To have a mentor dropped in your lap along with Buddy.
Yes, exactly. Needed both of them for sure.
The second book has a couple of interesting characters that we meet from the get-go. Let's talk about Letty Espinoza and her 15-year-old son, Alex. When we first meet Letty, you give us a lot of information. I have to say, she's a hot mess.
I think that's a good description.
She's drunk when we meet her.
Uh-huh.
She's just a young mother of two children. Neither of the fathers are the same. Letty's parents have raised her children, and now they've decided to return to Mexico, their home. Letty is in a panic because she's finally going to have to parent her children. This is a very unsympathetic character, mm-hmm. and I was wondering, what, there's a trust thing going on here that you trust that the reader is going to stick with you.
Right. And that was a big leap, I think, for both of my books. And I think in the early drafts of both of my books, I wrote truly unlikable characters. Like the kind of characters where my mom, who has loved everything I've ever done, has slammed the book down after 50 pages and refused to read anymore. So if you can believe it, both Victoria and Letty went through a lot of softening over the drafts. And I think for me with Letty, I had to learn to love her as well. I mean, it's very hard to be sympathetic to a mother. You know, with Victoria, with Language of Flowers, so I'm skipping around, but I think it's very clear that she wants to love her baby and feels like she doesn't know how. With Letty, on the first page of the book, it feels like she's choosing to leave her children. And that's very hard to accept, and it was hard for me to accept, right? But I think about 3 years into the process, I had an epiphany about Letty, which was that it's not that she doesn't want to be a mother. That's the front she's putting on, like, you're a better mother, I'm busy doing other things, you know, you need to raise my children kind of thing. But I think that, I hope the reader gets, you know, 50 or so pages in, that she's just deeply afraid and feels very inadequate, and I think a lot of mothers feel that way and put on various fronts.
You needed to drop little crumbs along the way to keep the reader going with you, though, because mm-hmm. she does some pretty, without giving away what these things are, some things that aren't very likable.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, I think that is, with both my books, I feel like the goal is to keep the reader going with these characters, and you do need those little moments that build empathy. And I think with Victoria in The Language of Flowers, I was able to do it by giving those little flashbacks into her life in foster care. I was really nervous about doing that because the last thing I wanted to do with The Language of Flowers was really propagate what I feel like are the stereotypes of the foster care system, the abuse and the neglect, but in the hands of foster parents. I didn't want to write about that, but my editor actually insisted and said, we will never love Victoria if we don't know just this much about what happened to her. And I felt the same when I was building the character of Letty. I had to provide just enough flashbacks into the harshness of her own life and the mistakes she made early on as a mother. And also those glimmers of moments where she tried. You know, there's this one really short scene that flashes back and it shows Letty comes home completely drunk from work one night. And before she can even, she's a bartender, before she can even wake up, her son Alex as a toddler wakes up and comes in her bed and she starts to read to him, and it's like this first moment that she's starting to bond, and then her mom swoops in, takes the baby, says you better go back to sleep, and she realizes in that moment, like, oh my God, I'm still drunk, what am I have no right to be reading to my child. And so I think those are the moments that I'm hoping when I'm writing will build enough empathy for my readers to keep going.
So let's move on to Alex then. He's the Letty's firstborn. But he defies the odds of the life into which he was born. He's very bookish. He's bright. His circumstances haven't flattened his enthusiasm for life. And he's a very resourceful and enterprising kid. As I was reading the book and thinking about Alex, it made me wonder, who are the resourceful teenagers in your life, mm-hmm. after which Alex may or may not have been?
Right. Well, I think it's interesting talking about Alex right after Letty, because I think in many ways they have exact opposite trajectories. So Letty really starts out a hot mess, as you know, aptly point out. And then for her, it's really a coming of age story, even though she's 32, right, when the book starts. But she's learning how to be an adult and responsible and care for her family. Alex, I think, is one of those kids, and I've known many of them in my own life, but also in my work in foster care before I was a foster parent. There are a lot of kids that have to grow up and be the adult in the family far before they're ready to do that, right? And so I think for me, Alex was, that's really his trajectory. He starts the book being able to immediately take care of his 6-year-old sister, even though he's only 15, and live alone and more or less cook for them and take them to school. Mm-hmm. And by the end of, and he's sort of one of those kids that's never done anything wrong because he just doesn't have that luxury, right? Like, he has to be perfect to survive. And by the end of the book, he makes a really big mistake, and I don't want to give it away, but I think for him, his trajectory is about learning that you don't have to be perfect and you can let people take care of you. And I've had lots of kids like that in my life, but I think that Trayvon, who's my second oldest son, he moved in when he was 14 and lived with us for 4 years and then went to college. But he was definitely one of those kids. He'd been left alone a lot. He was a lot of my inspiration for Alex. So I would call Trayvon and say, you know, what about this scenario? What about this scenario? I really wanted to understand what it's like to be a smart, ambitious 14-year-old, 15-year-old kid who's in a school system where no one expects anything from you. And really, no one's trying to teach you anything. I mean, I've been in so many urban school districts where there's a worksheet on the desk, and it's the same one you did yesterday, and you better not complain about it, right? So what does it feel like to be that kid? And then where do you get your information? And how do you stimulate your mind? And, you know, I called Trayvon and asked him exactly that question, and he said, well, I had the S. I said, what do you mean you had the S? And somewhere along the life, his life, he'd gotten a copy of the S encyclopedia. So he could tell you, this is in my book, he could tell you anything about the salamander. Like, do not ask him about the salamander unless you want a very long answer. But just so resourceful and ambitious and driven, right? And I had a lot of fun writing about Alex.
You were kind of a resourceful teenager yourself. There's a wonderful story of when you arrived at college at Stanford. You had a scholarship, and I was reading that it was almost immediately withdrawn.
Right.
And the part I love about this story is your roommate said, why don't you just go to the ATM and get more money? And right. You went and did right. What?
Well, yes, my roommate did say that to me. And I did not know how to respond because, you know, there wasn't any money on the other side of the ATM for me. There was for her, apparently. But, you know, I didn't know this, but when they send you your scholarship letter, that's like a proposal about, you know, approximately how much you qualify for. But that's like really matters, right? So I got there and they didn't cut my whole scholarship, but they'd readjusted it by $5,000. And I didn't have $5,000, you know, and my parents didn't have $5,000 that they were going to give me at least. So I got a job. I went and I got a job at Banana Republic on the first day of school, and then I started nannying about 2 weeks later. And by the end of my freshman year, I was waiting tables every night.
So crawling back into bed and pulling up the covers wasn't an option?
Yeah, it definitely did not cross my mind. I'd been working since I was about 13, so I was ready.
There's some intertwined themes in We Never Asked for Flowers, the role of family and migration to the United States. You've got characters who were born here, characters who have come here, characters who have come here through extra legal methods. Couldn't have picked a theme that's more current.
Right.
I imagine in California, your home, the immigration thing is just front and center. We here in northern Michigan have to worry about the Canadians
right.
coming.
I'm sure.
from the north to take advantage of all our amenities here. So,
yes.
How did the current situation in discussion about migration inform how you wrote about it in this book?
Mm-hmm. So I'll be honest here and say that I did not set out to write a book about immigration, and I think I probably would have chosen not to, right? Just because it's such a hot button issue, and I don't think I'm necessarily the right representative for that cause. However, I desperately wanted to write about educational inequality in the United States. My husband was a principal, and now he's a superintendent, and he's always worked in urban and low-income school districts. So I knew that I wanted that to be a central theme in my book. And I started to write about it, and I realized it's not authentic to write a book about educational inequality in California, set in California, and have every character be white. right? Like, that's not actually what our urban schools look like. And so I had worked in East Palo Alto after I graduated from Stanford, and Stanford, you know, is in Palo Alto, and it's where Stanford and Facebook and Google and, you know, the heart of the Silicon Valley, extreme wealth. And then right on the other side of 101, just how I've described it in the book, is a community called East Palo Alto, which has been historically African American, although now there's a lot of recent immigrants. When I worked there, it was the homicide per capita capital of the country, so a lot of drugs, a lot of crime. I worked there for 3 years after college, and I wanted to write about that extreme inequality that we have, you know, really juxtaposed right up against it. And I found when I worked there that what really struck me was the isolation that those kids feel. You know, they could throw a stone to the other side or walk in a half an hour to Stanford, but none of the kids I'd worked with had ever been to Stanford, ever. So there's just this complete separation. And I wanted to write about that, and so I sat down to write about this community, and I came up with this Mexican-American family, and I've lived in Mexico and I speak Spanish, so it was a culture I felt excited to write about. And then as I was writing about it, I realized, well, it's not really authentic either to have everyone be documented, right? Like, that's just not how it is either. And so Alex starts to fall in love with this girl named Yesenia, who's one of my favorite characters. And I just decided she should be undocumented because that felt right to me. Turns out that becomes a major plot point, because when you're undocumented, you can do one thing wrong, you know, or not, or, you know, one thing can go not as planned, and all of a sudden the entire life that you've built for yourself can be taken away in an instant.
Was this the kind of thing where you've got all the post-it notes on your wall and you're rearranging them to get all the moving parts moving in the right direction?
Yeah. I don't write fiction that way. I do actually write nonfiction that way. I'm just starting to write a little nonfiction. But with fiction, I know when I start the book a moment that I'm writing towards. So in Language of Flowers, I was writing towards the moment where Victoria scrapes the moss off the redwood trees and lines the basket and puts the baby in it. And I knew I was going there, and I had absolutely no idea how. So I just sort of plow straight through and then had to, of course, restructure 100 times when it was over. With We Never Asked for Wings, I don't want to give away too much, but there's a moment that Alex makes a big mistake that has to do with the school system, and they get in serious trouble, and it changes everything for everyone. And I knew I was writing to that moment, but
so
I don't outline.
It was just a matter of figuring out all the little parts that,
exactly, that get
lead
you
up
there.
To that. I thought you did a really skillful job of taking a hot button subject and weaving it into the plot the way you did. You didn't shy away from some of the more unsavory aspects of being undocumented.
I did a lot of research. So once I realized that I had a character that was undocumented and then it really mattered to the plot and that there were going to be all these legal consequences, I called everyone I knew, all my friends from Stanford that had gone on to law school, and said, I need someone who works in childhood immigration and juvenile justice. And it was so hard. I interviewed 4 different people before I understood it, because it's just so complicated and it changes all the time, and it's hard to tell, you know, what legislation has passed and what hasn't, and how it affects kids. So when I finally understood it and I toured juvenile hall, then I was able to, I feel like, really get it right. But it was a lot harder than I'd expected.
Letty's father is a feather painter. It's an art form that is full of tradition, ritual. It's very precise, and it necessitates a close relationship with the natural world. It's very arcane. So tell us how you know about feather painting.
Yeah, so my husband has always known that he wanted to be in education. And so when we got married, we decided to move to Mexico because he wanted to learn Spanish, and he is serious about everything he does. So we've been married 4 days, and he's coming down into the country on the airplane, and he turns to me and says, just so you know, when we land in Mexico, I'm not speaking English to you. And he didn't speak Spanish at all. He had taken one class his, like, sophomore year in high school. I mean, he did not speak Spanish, so he carried around his little dictionary. We had to make a rule that if we started to fight, we had to switch to English, because most of the time we just had no idea what the other person was talking about. Anyway, so we lived in Mexico a year, and one of the things we loved to do was just take the bus on weekends when we weren't working and travel to these little villages. We had a book on Mexican folk art, and you know, this was 2003, so I guess the internet existed, but it wasn't the way it is today. And so if you wanted to meet one of these artists, there wasn't a phone number or an email, there was just an address. And so you would take the bus to these tiny towns that would take three or four buses to get there. And one of the towns we went to was in Michoacan, and it was this family called the Ole Ole family. And they'd been making these Mexican feather paintings for four generations. And you know, we just knock on the door and they are so happy to see us and invite us in. And they have jars, glass jars, full of every color feather you could imagine, every pattern, all organized. The grandfather told me if a bird died anywhere in the state of Michoacan, somebody brought it to his doorstep. Like, they were just known for it. And so the way they do it, like, his whole house smells like melting wax. And they take these rollers and they roll a certain kind of like old Aztec wax onto canvas, and then they take natural feathers without any dye and they stick them in the wax. So it sounds like it would be fairly imprecise, but just to give you an example of the kind of detail, like, they would do, you know, Virgin Mary with like all the facial features, and they would do these landscapes with women in shawls and beautiful portraits of faces. They almost look like oil paintings, like the feathers look like brush strokes. And they would make even their signature, the word ole, in feathers. So it's just, it was an amazing art form.
Is it the kind of thing that a person, any person would have in their home, or was it the kind of art that was reserved for people of means?
Right, so when they did well, which I think was generations ago, it was very popular in Europe. And so they traveled, and this is a little bit in my book too. Letty's family has this beautiful, dilapidated mansion in Mexico that her parents go back to, but this family had an old marble staircase that had been imported from Italy. But you know, nobody buys feather paintings anymore. It's sort of fallen out of fashion, so the house was kind of falling apart, but also very grand at the same time. It was interesting.
You never come right out and say this, but the point is really hard to miss. Wings illustrates the critical need for engaged adults in the lives of children. And your book also presents different ways that a family can be and can look like. Not all of them biological relationships. Mm-hmm. Again, your life and your fiction are commingling. So I'd like to, why don't you tell us about your own family?
Sure. So my husband and I have been married 12 years, and we have two biological children that are 7 and 8, and then we have a 23-year-old and a 25-year-old. And so the order they came into our lives are, we had our biological daughter first, and when she was 6 months old, we went to court and got custody of Trayvon, who had been one of my husband's students, and he'd run away from home from a very abusive situation and had been taken into custody. So we went to court to get Trayvon, and the week we got custody, I had like 5 banana milkshakes in a row and then realized I was pregnant with our son, Miles. And then Miles was born 9 months later, and that week, actually, a young woman named Sharon moved in. So we managed to have 4 children in 16 months, which is quite hard to do. And that year, I started Language of Flowers, which seems crazy to me, looking back on it. You know, it was a busy time. But Sharon lived with us for a year and went to college, and then Donovan was one of those kids you read about that was put into foster care at 2 weeks old, was raised in 6 or 8 foster homes, never found a family, never found anyone that really loved him and permanently. And so when he was 18, he packed up his stuff and was put out onto the street, and he was another one of my husband's students. So he came to stay with us before he went to college, and then dropped out of college and came back to live with us. And so it was in our life on and off for the last 6 years, and then we ended up adopting him legally last July. So he's our oldest son.
And Trayvon's just graduated from college.
Trayvon just graduated from college, that's right. So my big boys are, you know, in this moment doing okay. You know how it is as a mom.
Let's move on to the language of flowers. And let's also say that a million copies sold.
Yep.
Is that worldwide?
That's just in the U.S.
Aye, aye, aye.
Yeah, I know, it's amazing. Yeah. There were 600,000 hard copies just in Italy. So Italy was my other big country, but I just came back from Norway where it did very well as well.
And this is also very interesting. The Norwegians and the Italians just love you.
Yeah.
I mean, you're hard not to love.
PK says I have a paparazzi in Italy. It's so funny. It's different there. It is. I think books are different. In Italy and Norway, like, they still, like, almost exclusively buy hardcovers. And they want the first edition, and they want them signed, and they come out in huge numbers to events. I had one event at the Roman Forum with about 3,000 people. It's amazing. It was amazing.
Did they keep the lions and the Christians inside too? Yeah. Is there any way to tell if the Italians are also reading all these books, or is it that, no, I'm in all seriousness,
yeah.
Or is the book precious and it's just enough to
no,
own it?
I mean, the book industry has just in the last few years really taken a hit because their economy is doing badly, but, you know, I think this book really hit a nerve with the Italians for a few reasons. They just fiercely love children, right? So the idea of neglect and abuse for children is something, you know, there were other countries that cared about the flowers. I never got one question in Italy about a flower. It was all about the kids and how do we love children. And then the other thing that was really interesting and just sort of a lucky fluke was that when the book came out, they were just passionately debating this issue of, let me just tell you this little story. My first interview ever for the book, because it actually, Language of Flowers came out in Italy before it even came out in the US. They fly a reporter from Vanity Fair to San Francisco to interview me. And the first question I get is, do you believe in gay marriage? I do not have a gay person or couple in either of my books. But it turns out that in Italy, it is illegal for gay people to marry or adopt children. And because of that, it is also illegal for single people to adopt children because you might actually be gay. So there was this debate going on with the church and the politicians, and I somehow ended up just right in the middle of it. And I get asked, I mean, I live in San Francisco, you can probably guess my politics, but I also, that morning, I had spent the night with my friend Angela and her wife Susie and their son Nico. And I know it's a Catholic country, and it's my first book, and, you know, I'm nervous, but for me, there's only one answer. You know, I believe that children need to be loved, and whoever can come forward to love a child, that's what we need. So I ended up being sort of the poster child for gay marriage in Italy.
You're amazing.
Yeah, pretty funny.
And as you pointed out, the issue of gay marriage or same-sex couples adopting, it has nothing to do with anything going on in this book. We're introduced to Victoria, an 18-year-old who's aging out of the foster care system, and she's being introduced to the world on her 18th birthday, a suitcase in hand, and that's about it. But the one thing that she takes with her is this language of flowers that she's learned. So tell us a little bit about the language of flowers. Mm-hmm. And before I forget, these flowers that are speaking to all of us were gathered locally by Penny Kriebel.
So. They're beautiful, beautiful. I was distracted by their beauty. So the language of flowers is a an actual language that was invented in, well, there's many stories about how it was invented, but it was wildly popular in France and England in the 1800s, and people would actually give each other flowers that had secret messages. And so the women of the day who, you know, were huge gardeners, they still are in England, many of them, they'd have garden clubs, and they'd all have Language of Flowers books on their coffee tables, and they would debate the meanings, and so it was just this language. So in my book, you know, one of the, Victoria's obsessed with the Language of Flowers because the only person who tried to adopt her had taught her the Language of Flowers. So instead of, you know, using red roses to convey love, Victoria is using she's using rhododendron to convey beware, and she's using basil to convey hate, and she's using lavender to convey mistrust, and she's leaving sort of a trail of flowers as she goes in life. And it's perfect for her because not only does nobody know what she's saying, nobody knows that she's saying anything at all, right? And so nobody ever responds, which is just fine with her.
She's kind of sullen. She keeps her own counsel in a lot of ways.
Yeah, she's very solitary at the beginning of the book.
What's your relationship to gardens and flowers?
Well, the funny thing is, so I got to speak at the Royal Horticultural Society in London, and I've been asked to, you know, lots of garden clubs and to talk about flowers, and every time I do, I start to sweat, and I, you know, do all this research, and I over-prepare with like 100 note cards, because the truth is I'm not a gardener at all. I don't know anything about flowers. When I wrote this book, I had my mom on one line and my sister-in-law on the other. My mom is an incredible gardener and knows the name of every plant, and my sister-in-law is a botanist, and so she could talk about the science of the plants. And so, you know, I'd be writing a scene, and I'd call one of them up, and I'd say, okay, Victoria's walking in San Francisco, and I need to know what's, you know, growing. And they'd be like, well, what neighborhood is she in? And is it June, and is it a foggy day, and is it morning? And, you know, how has the season been for, you know, on a million questions. But it turns out it's very complicated. You know, you can't just say Victoria goes and picks cosmos if you're, like, you know, in the east, the lower sunset, and it's been a foggy summer, you know. I mean, so I learned a lot. I did a lot of research, but it's not something I came into the book knowing a lot about.
I don't know if I necessarily think having a practical knowledge of gardening is essential. It seems as though the Victorians cared more about the secretive language and the kind of circular ways of talking that flowers offered them.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. And I think the other thing that was hard about this, just not knowing a lot going in, was that I believed, like Victoria does, if you start the book, she believes that every flower has exactly one meaning. That's what Elizabeth teaches her, and to avoid confusion, which would make sense. But it turns out in the Victorian era, every woman who had a spare hour wrote their own dictionary, it seems like. So there are hundreds of old dictionaries, and they all have different definitions. And so I went into the book thinking there is a language of flowers that exists and is precise and accurate. And then I get three or four chapters in, and I had a book that had the yellow rose listed in the glossary as jealousy and in the index as indiscretion in the same book. And I went, oh, weird, there was an error. I better go to the library, get another book, and figure out what it really is. And then I go to the library and pull out a bunch of books and see like four other definitions for the yellow rose. And I'm like, oh, my book is ruined. I can't write this book, right? And I go through a spiral. And then I realize, oh, you know, that just became part of the plot, her discovery that there's more than one meaning.
And then your publisher, Random House, released a book entitled A Victorian Flower Dictionary, for which you wrote the introduction, the foreword.
Yeah.
It's a lovely foreword, and I loved the last paragraph. May I read that?
Sure, of course.
We plant, we nurture, we grow, and we give different flowers for different moments in time, but all for the same purpose, to say that which cannot be said and to say it with beauty and grace. The part about saying that which cannot be said.
Yeah, I mean, I think the Victorians really, really tried to assign, you know, meanings, but I think flowers speak for themselves. I think that's right.
Yes, and they still do, don't they? Mm-hmm. The foster care system is a central character in this book. Early on, we learn that Victoria's travels through foster care include a stay in some very Dickensian mm-hmm. homes. There was a beautiful detail you offered where she said she doesn't like to be around, hear people breathing, and that was something she carried from living in foster care, where you're probably cheek by jowl mm-hmm. sometimes. How did you arrive at those kinds of details and mm-hmm. those kinds of perceptions of foster care?
Well, I've worked in, so my first job out of college was working at a Boys and Girls Club, but after that I went to work with families that were homeless and teenagers that were homeless and teenagers in foster care. So I've spent the vast majority of my professional life working with young people that are in foster care. So I've heard a lot of stories. And then I've also had lots of my own foster kids. So some of the details are pulled directly from mm-hmm. my own experience. One that comes to mind is when Trayvon first came to live with us, he was only 5'1". And when he moved out mm-hmm. 4 years later, he was almost 6'1". And he says he grew 12 inches despite my cooking, which is very true. But he was very undernourished, and food had been a big part of his abuse, which is really common. You know, kids aren't, don't have access to the kind of nutrition and food they need. So for him, he hadn't had enough to eat. And so one of the things he did for the first few months, maybe 2 or 3, he had one of those little backpacks that are just made out of rope, and he wore it everywhere, absolutely everywhere, you know. Mowing the lawn and, you know, just wherever he was in the house, he was wearing it, into the bathroom. And I finally just, like, curiosity overcame me and some, you know, finally got into that, see that backpack. And it just had whatever he hadn't quite finished eating that day, you know, half a granola bar and a few slices of apple and some rotten things at the bottom. But there's that need to feel in control of your health and safety that I think is really primal. And in one of the first scenes or early in the book, there's a moment when Victoria's not even hungry, but she starts stuffing slices of American cheese down her socks, you know, and I think that's just those kinds of behaviors you wouldn't know if you hadn't worked in the system.
Victoria's story mirrors the reality for 20 to 30,000 U.S. kids in foster care, who are aging out of foster care and have no place to go. And again, here's one of these lovely things where I get to say your life mm-hmm. intersects with your fiction. So tell us about the Camilla Network mm-hmm. and Youth Villages.
Sure, so when I sold this book in this incredible way, which was really quite a shock to my system, as I mentioned, I had the opportunity to go all across the country and around the world, and I had people say to me over and over and over, I would have people say, well, this doesn't happen anymore, does it? You know, this isn't happening in Michigan or in Ohio or wherever I was. This isn't happening here. And I'd have to say, no, this is happening every day to 20 to 30,000 kids, as you mentioned, are aging out. And Michigan is one of the few states that's changed their laws so that you can opt to stay until 21, which is a really big deal. But most states still don't have that option. So I'd have to say, it's happening. And then people would say, well, what can I do about it? You know, and there was this sort of desperate need of the people that I was meeting all over the country wanted to be put to work, right? And I wanted to put them to work. And the more I thought about it, the more I felt like one of the main problems with foster care is if you're not willing or able to be a foster or adoptive parent, which is a huge ask for most people, there's really not a lot you can do. There's a lot of laws that exist to keep kids safe and protected and their identities protected, right? But those same laws also keep kids really isolated. So most of us don't know who the kids are in our communities that are aging out and what they need, and I felt like that was a really big problem. So I got together with a dear friend of mine who is a strategist and like a marketing person, really. And we launched Camellia Network, which has just been acquired by Youth Villages, which is one of the premier nonprofits in the country. And what we do is we give young people the opportunity to tell their story and talk about where they're going, what they need to be successful, and then give my readers and anyone who logs onto our website direct access to get them the things they need to meet their goals. So if kids are going to college, you can go on right now and buy them their computer or their bike or their helmet or their blow dryer, right? Just, it could be $10 or it could be $250. All that money goes directly to buy that item that gets sent immediately to that kid. So it's a pretty cool, very direct way to make an impact. And we've only served about 300 kids because it was a lot harder to get it off the ground than I thought. But Youth Villages is phenomenal, and we're hoping to really bring it to scale. And they have a plan to roll out not only the network that I created, which is called LifeSet Network now, and I have bookmarks if you're interested. But we're rolling out LifeSet Network at the same time that they're rolling out their program, which is YV LifeSet. And what LifeSet does is provide for a period of about 6 to 12 months an on-call, 24 hours a day, person that young people can reach out to get support with jobs, housing, school, whatever they need, whenever they need it. And they just released their first study. They did a clinical trial to see if it was actually working, because they're really into making sure things work before they roll out programs. And it had incredible results for housing stability and for job security. So I'm excited to be part of that organization, because I felt like I had created something that was just a little piece of the puzzle. You know, I needed to give every single person in the country a way to support young people in their community to reach their goals. And then what LifeSet does is really fill in that, you know, physical, tangible person and the emotional component for those kids so that they can really reach those goals. Oh, thank you.
Can't imagine that when you were a little girl in your bedroom dreaming what you wanted to be when you grew up, you saw all this play out before your eyes. Are you, no. How surprised are you by all this?
You know, I honestly, you know, I believed that I would sell Language of Flowers. I did. I had written another book before and I never believed I would sell it. But when I started Language of Flowers, I was ready. I knew it was the book and I was going to sell it. And I told my husband, I'm going to sell this book, and I'm going to make $50,000. And he was like, I love you, I believe in you, and that's a lot of money. Like, I just think you need to, like, manage your expectations. But I did reach the goal.
Good. In both of your books, This is an interesting technique you use. A lot of critical details are delayed. You don't lay it out nice and neat at the beginning and say, these are the tools you need, reader, so that you can go through this complex story. Again, I go back to the whole trust thing with the reader. That's assuming that a lot of trust on the part of your readers that they're going to stick with you.
It's true, but it also keeps you interested, right? And, you know, I was explaining to some friends right before the event that when I started Language of Flowers, I didn't know how to write a novel. I'd taken a few creative writing classes in undergrad, but I wanted to learn. And so one of the first things I did was I physically tore apart a copy of The Kite Runner, chapter by chapter. And I pinned it to my wall, and I just analyzed it and tried to figure out, because I was trying to write a page-turner. I wanted to write a good book, a literary book, but I wanted to write a book that was hard to put down. That was really important to me. I didn't want to be boring. And so I took The Kite Runner because I thought it was beautifully written, and I also could not put that book down. And so at the end of the chapter, at the end of every single chapter, I asked myself, why do I want to keep reading? And a lot of the times, it's because he's withholding little details. Mm-hmm. And they're not big things. I don't like it when there's that huge surprise at the end of the book and you feel like you're just reading for that, you know, to figure out that one secret. I personally, those are not my favorite kinds of books. But if there are little details that you're waiting for or that you're curious about, it's a good way to keep the reader going.
Why don't you tell us the story about, we're going to go back to We Never Asked for Wings. The writing was not going well, as you've told us, and you kind of hit a brick wall with it. Mm-hmm. And so how did you get around that brick wall?
Mm-hmm. So I got to a place about 3 years into writing this book, and it was hard. I mean, when people told me everywhere I went that, oh, book two is so hard, I'm so sorry, you know? And I believed it, and so I think I kind of brought that on myself in a little way. But it is hard, and I think I care a lot about my readers, right? It wasn't that I was like so nervous about the reviews. It was that I knew, I hoped I would be invited around the country to talk about my book, and I wanted to write a book that people cared about. I mean, that was the best thing about Language of Flowers, was people connected with the character, connected with the story, and I wanted to do that again. So it was a lot of pressure. And I got to a point 3 years in where it was probably my third or fourth complete draft where I realized that the plot and the structure were exactly right. And the book had no heart, right? Like, none of the characters were likable or felt real. There was no emotion. And that's just a tragedy. Like, for me and the kinds of books that I write, there's nothing worse than that. You can add a plot. I added a plot, and the very last thing I did with Language of Flowers was add the plot. But the heart of the book, if you don't feel it, and my books make me cry when I'm writing them, right? So if I'm not feeling it, I expect that my readers will not as well. So I got to a point where I knew I had to pull the heart out, which means that I had to pretty much rewrite every single page of the book. And I had been working on it 3 years, and I was exhausted. And so I ended up hiring a friend of mine, because I sent her the first draft, or I sent her the first few pages, and she read it, and she said, oh, I can see why you hate it, you know, it's, you know, she goes, the problem is, you fell in love with this location, which I did, and you spend, you know, 10 pages describing it, but we don't feel it, and all you need to do is take this one moment and add a character and blow it up into scene, and then all of a sudden we get the place, because the place is cool, but we're not bored out of our mind, you know, so that's why you need an editor, right? And I went home and I did that, and it solved it. And so I called her and I said, I need your help. I don't want to just like pay you a few thousand dollars to give me a read. Like, I want you on call. Like, what will it cost that you will answer my phone call whenever I call for the next 4 months? And she was an editor, and so she, you know, we came to terms. But I hired her to be an editor and a coach and keep me going. And then the other thing I did, I find it really hard when I'm deep into the work to be a good mother and to be a good writer. Is really hard because both of them are so all-consuming. And so what I decided to do was leave my family every Monday morning at 6 a.m. and I went to a hotel room and I wrote for about 36 hours and I had a completely rigid routine. I brought the same food, I wore the same outfit, I took breaks at the same time, and I was able to having that long stretch of time and then still writing the rest of the week. I rewrote, you know, a 300-page book in about 4 months, 5 months. Yeah, so it was hard, but I got through it. It felt like childbirth. Like, if I can do this book, I can do anything, you know?
In both of these novels, you tackle subjects that aren't comfortable for the reader, and they're kind of horrific for some of the people in the story. Where do you find the emotional energy to tackle some of these things? You have said on several occasions since you've been here that you've cried over mm-hmm. your own stories.
Yeah. I had a friend actually who's a poet and asked me that. She said that she feels like in order to write specific emotions. She has to feel them at the time she's writing them, and that some things are just too much for her and she won't do it. That's a good question, and I haven't been asked that before. I think for me, what I'm really interested in life is love and family and connection and the way that we come together and try to make change in ourselves and in the world. And that's not comfortable, right? It's not always comfortable and it's not always pretty and it's never easy. But I think you write about what you're interested in. And so I think I'm willing to kind of go there emotionally because it's what I care about.
You've written two books that take on contemporary issues that are very heavy-hearted. If you wake up tomorrow, however, and you think, aha, I want nothing better to do than to write a bodice ripper, is your third novel.
That'd be awesome.
Can you give yourself permission to do something that is not so densely serious and important? Have you written yourself into a corner?
So I was just talking to Doug about this. I don't want to write a third book in the same genre right now. I may someday, but I feel like it's so easy to start to churn out the same book over and over again, and I don't want to do that. I want to feel challenged. And so I have two ideas, and also the writers I really respect, like Joan Didion and Alice Walker, they don't just write the same genre even. They're writing nonfiction and they're writing essays, and I really want to get into some maybe long-form journalism. I have some ideas for some nonfiction, although I don't think it will be a full book. So I want to start there. I also have always wanted to write for kids, like a middle grade, that kind of age. So I do think I'll do something different next just to give myself a mental break and not get repetitive.
You are the mom of a 9-year-old girl, and this is a kid that personifies the nut not falling far from the tree. She is making vests for dogs, profits from which are given to the Humane Society. And she is also an enterprising and resourceful teenager. Why don't you tell everyone the lovely story about the project she got going?
The school play?
Yes.
So my husband is a superintendent, as I mentioned, and my two biological children had the experience of moving from Newport Beach, which is one of the wealthiest areas in California, and the public schools are funded, to the extreme level, and they go surfing and have field trips and have art twice a week and they have dance. So she moved from that to where my husband is the superintendent of the Monterey Peninsula Unified School District, which if you've been to Monterey, it's gorgeous and you'd think it would have a great school system. But if you have resources and you live in the Monterey area, your kids go to school in Carmel or Pacific Grove or to private school. And so Monterey actually serves the student population is 75% free and reduced lunch, about 40% Spanish speaking. So a lot of recent immigrants, a lot of farm workers' kids, service industry kids. The schools are not well funded at all. So she moved to a school that had no art, no music, no science, no PE. Her day was 3 hours of math, 2 hours of English language arts, and then 2 hours of English language development, which is for English language learners. And that was her whole day. And my daughter is an artist and she's creative. And so she told me, all she wanted was a school play. And so I told her, we're all here together. We're in this together. We have to support your dad and the schools. And so we together have to make this the school you want it to be. And so if that's important to you, that's what we need to do. So we had a big cookie making party and she invited all her friends and all the moms spoke Spanish and I speak some Spanish, but none of us can bake. None of us could bake. So we tried to make those peanut butter cookies with the Hershey's Kiss on top, but we put the Hershey's Kiss in the batter. was a disaster. Anyway, so my daughter baked for months with her friends. They got pretty good at it. And they had bake sales. They made enough money to hire a director. And they put on a school play. And they made all the costumes themselves. They had one machine and a whole bunch of hot glue and a lot of feathers. A lot of feathers. And they put on Aladdin Jr. And they all looked like chickens, you know, because there were so many feathers. And it was great. There was a great director. They really learned how to sing and dance. It was a very short production. And then later, Trayvon, our older son, was graduating from college, and we went to New York, and we saw Aladdin on Broadway. She loved it. And then she turns to me afterwards, and she's like, that was so great. Ours was a little better, don't you think? So it was great. I mean, it's been a hard experience because there's so many things I feel like she's not getting in her education that I would wish she was getting, but she's having this really incredible opportunity of seeing that you can make change in the world and you can be with people that don't look like you and form friendships. And so it's been overall positive, but there are still days that we doubt ourselves as parents, for sure.
So on that happy note, would you like to take some questions from the audience?
I'd love to, if anyone has questions. I can't see you very well.
There
Ooh,
we go.
That's so nice.
Hello.
You're lovely.
When you receive the microphone, would you introduce yourself and please stand up?
I will take the question of the first hand that I see go up. So,
let's see.
It's all up to you.
Don't be shy.
There are.
Have we answered all questions?
Oh, no, there's someone in the back.
There's someone way in the back here.
Thank you.
There we go.
My name's Chris.
Hi,
Alan.
Chris.
Have you read T.C. Boyle's Tortilla Curtain?
I haven't.
Oh, it's really good about the contrast between immigrants' experience.
Yeah.
And a Californian's.
Oh, thank you for the recommendation.
Recommend
I've heard of it, and I would love to read it.
You know, the last time the subject of adoption in foster care was so big in the popular culture was the film Blindside.
The Blindside, right. Yep.
You've heard of that.
Yep.
Question?
No.
Oh, please. There's got to be. Don't be shy. Over right here. This lovely woman's with the green shawl.
Hi, thanks.
Hi.
My name is Carrie, and I've not read either book yet, but looking forward to it. But I was just curious, listening to it, sounds like both books contain adult characters and children, child characters, and there's such a trend right now towards young adult literature.
Right.
And I was wondering what made, it sounds like both the books are mostly written from the adult point of view, but maybe you could tell us, is that the case, and why did you choose to do adult point of view versus young adult?
That's a great question. And actually, both of my books are told pretty much 50-50. My most recent book is Letty, the mother, and then Alex, the 15-year-old, and it goes back and forth. My other book is all Victoria, but it's Victoria when she was 18 and then Victoria when she's about 10, and it goes back and forth in time. So when I started Language of Flowers, I thought I was writing YA. That had been my intention. And I got about two chapters in, and I thought, you know what? This is not YA. And so I kept going, and I decided I was going to write an adult novel. But the way I had structured the book originally was that I started at Victoria's birth. I wrote all the way through her childhood up to her 40th birthday. Chronologically, it was excruciatingly boring. But there it was. And so I found an amazing agent who read it and said, this is an adult book. You need to start when she's an adult. I think you should start on her 18th birthday. And that's what I ended up doing. And I kept just a little bit of her childhood. But there's a pretty much a rule in publishing, although, of course, brilliant writers can break it, that if you're writing adult literature, it has to be from an adult perspective. And so even with my second book, I wanted to start from Alex's perspective. And the original first chapter was him waking up alone. And they said, yeah, you have to start with Letty. And so I wrote the world's worst first chapter from Letty's perspective, because that wasn't the start of the book for me. And that was the start of the book until last December. I was on my last round of copy edits. I hated the first chapter. I was just praying all of you who had liked my first book would buy it anyway, but I knew the first chapter was terrible. And my brother-in-law read it and said, "Wow, your first chapter is terrible. It doesn't even seem like you're writing." And so we sat down over Christmas on Christmas Day, and he figured out the solution, which was basically I needed a page from Letty's perspective, and all the rest that I wrote I could cut or put other places. Thank you for that question.
Hi, we have a question up here.
Yep, here I come.
It's right here.
Here we are.
Good evening. Thank you so much for giving us some of the insight. And but you haven't really talked too much about the mechanics of your writing.
Mm-hmm.
Do you say, well, let's say you come up with a subject in your, or something comes into your head. Do you sit down and say, okay, I'm going to write this all out? With your busy life, how do you do it?
Yeah, so that's a great question. And so I read this wonderful interview with Dave Eggers and Juno Diaz. And Juno Diaz talks about how he's so jealous of his friend who's a surgeon, because every surgery he performs, he learns something that then is applicable to the next surgery. And he said that with writing, he feels like every book and every scene and every story is its own complex set of problems that takes a completely unique solution. And I completely agree with that. So I could tell you how I wrote Language of Flowers. And I could tell you how I wrote We Never Asked for Wings, and they were completely different. So I don't outline, really, but I come up with, you know, a point I'm writing to, as I mentioned. And Language of Flowers was completely character-driven. So it took me writing her entire life to figure her out, and then I figured out the structure, and then I figured out the plot. With We Never Asked for Wings, I knew the plot. I knew the plot from the very first moment the story came to me. And of course, there were some twists and turns along the way, but figuring out the characters was really hard. So, I mean, I have a routine. I'm definitely a writer that I don't like sit around and wait to be inspired, right? I have hours a day that I commit to writing, and I try not to do word counts because I find when I do that, I feel so much pressure to write that I just write something even if it's bad. I try to commit to hours. Because I feel like, you know, some hours you're going to write 250 words and some hour, you know, days you're going to write 5,000. But if you've committed yourself to the time and done that time, then you've reached your goal.
Do you have a specific spot you like to write?
I've moved 7 times in the last 7 years. So I'd love to have a specific spot. I really would. But yeah, no, when I write long days, I move at least once during the day, so I'll write 3 hours at home and then 3 hours in a coffee shop. I can't ever write longer than that in one place. But, yeah.
Hi, we have a question up here.
Oh, hello.
Hi.
Our book club read Language of Flowers, and we had a lovely discussion about it, but many of us had a question. We couldn't quite figure out why Victoria's supposed to be mother backed out on the day that she was supposed to adopt her.
Right. So there's a scene where Elizabeth doesn't get out of bed, and she's taken her shopping for the dress, and it makes me, like, I get emotional even now. And it is tragic, and I think here's why I wrote that scene. I wrote the entire draft of The Language of Flowers and read it and thought to myself, oh, I just wrote the foster parent I want to be. She's so funny, and she's so strong, and she's so patient, and I'm not, you know, I'm not, and I don't think anyone is that perfect all the time. And so I went back through and really changed her character and gave her moments that she loses her temper and moments she makes mistakes. And so I've been a foster parent for 8 or 9 years now. I've had incredible successes with some of my kids. I've also had kids that I have not succeeded with. I had one young woman who we wanted to adopt, and we don't have any idea where she is anymore. She just left our family and, you know, said, I don't want to be here anymore. And so that was a heartbreak. The very first 2 kids I ever had, were beautiful, a 3-year-old and a 13-year-old sister, no behavior problems. I mean, the sweetest girls you could ever imagine, Latino girls, hair down to here, curly, full of lice, full. And you can't cut hair in foster care. The little one also had all her teeth rotting out. And I had a full-time job. And so these were beautiful, amazing, perfectly behaved children who had incredible needs, and I wasn't prepared for it, and I had a panic attack, and I was like the woman on the kitchen floor who like couldn't get up to make the grilled cheese sandwich. So I just wanted to write a more complex story. I wanted to write about a woman who wanted to be a good mother and did so many things right. I believe Elizabeth does so many things right. But on that day, she was overwhelmed, and it became too much for her, and she was desperately alone. I mean, there's no one else in Elizabeth's life. So, you know, that's my answer.
There's, over here.
Oh, also question over here.
Wall.
You talked about starting to write for YA and that these became adult novels, mm-hmm. but a lot of teens are reading them. What mm-hmm. is their feedback to you? And certainly teens are reading. I mean, Kite yeah. Runner is a great example.
Yeah. No, I have lots and lots of teenagers that read my books, and in other countries as well. I have a huge teenage population in Italy, and I love it. You know, I don't think there's anything really, you know, too vulgar or awful for teenagers in these books. I think they're emotionally a little intense, but teens are emotionally a little intense, right? I mean, this is the kind of thing that teenagers are thinking about and grappling with.
Hi, we have a question up here.
Got it.
Hi. I'm wondering how your adopted children responded to these stories and how, you know, what their reactions were, and also possibly how maybe you've inspired them to write about their lives or their experiences.
I don't think your own mother ever inspires you in that way, right? I don't know. I have two readers and two non-readers in my family. So my son Trayvon is a reader, and he's read both my books and, you know, worked with me really on We Never Asked for Wings in terms of character development. And then my daughter is an avid reader. And so she, in second grade, decided she was tired of hearing about The Language of Flowers and she needed to read it herself. And so she started it, and she was really confused by the time change. And so I ended up reading it to her, to just to kind of help her through it. And she was really mad at me, honestly. She felt like Victoria was too mean and too awful, and she didn't understand why she did a lot of the things. I mean, she was in second grade, she was 7. But she would say to me, "Mom, why is she doing this?" And I would say, "Well, you know, this and that," and, you know, these emotional, you know, complex answers. And she would say, "No, she's doing it because you made her do it. You're the writer, and she could have done something different." So it was pretty funny.
That one's going to be a challenge
yeah.
when she gets older.
Yeah, and she is a writer already. She wrote her first mystery in France, last year. So.
Other questions?
We have another one up here.
Okay,
we're rocking up here.
I know, I love it.
Hi again, Victoria. Vanessa, I mean, I'm sorry, I'm thinking Victoria.
I get that a lot, actually.
I wonder if you've ever heard from, via letter, from a foster child who read The Language of Flowers, and if you have a particular one that's a favorite or that was very meaningful to you.
Yeah, so I get that a lot, but I don't get it from teenagers as much as I do from older adults that have experienced foster care. And my favorite one of those was a woman who's 90 years old, and she had her great niece drive her from this little town near the Oregon border to an event that I had in Marin, and she just wanted to meet me. And she said that she had experienced foster care, and she spent her entire life reading books about foster care, and that she wanted to tell me that she thought I got it right. You know, and that was incredible from her.
Last night over dinner, you also told a lovely story about meeting older men
mm-hmm.
who communicate to you about their experience in foster care.
Yeah, I've had a lot of people come up in my signing lines and say, you know, sign my book and this and that. And by the way, I was in foster care and you know, I'm a businessman now and I'm doing this and I don't ever talk about it, but I just wanted you to know. It's me. Oh, there's somebody over here.
You mentioned earlier that you were looking at writing nonfiction. Mm-hmm. Will you be writing about foster care or your foundation?
So I'm getting a lot of support from the people in this room, actually, because it's really new for me, but there's a lot of people here that have written both journalism and nonfiction. So I've gotten a lot of good advice over the last 24 hours, and I'm starting to figure out what I want to focus on. But I really want to write more about education. You know, we've had this very, I think, interesting and unusual experience of choosing to put our daughter in a school that's 100% poverty and 100% minority. And I think that, you know, I've done a lot of research and a lot of thinking on it, and I want to write an article about the fact that, you know, it's not my husband and I trying to prove some political point. It's that I actually think there are things she's learning from that experience that she can't learn anywhere else and that are really important to her character and personal growth and sense of purpose. And I think that when we're making that school choice as parents, there's a lot of, you know, pressure and noise about what's the best school in our community, and you have to get into this and you have to apply by this date. And you know, when you walk on these campuses that have all the art and music, and it has this feeling about it, you know, that's what I want for my kid. And when you walk on my daughter's campus, you know, there's the blacktop's cracked, and you know, all the typical problems of a more high poverty school. But the culture of the community there, and the leadership, and the teachers, I think it's been good for her. And so I want to write this article that says, basically, we all want what's best for our children, absolutely. And like, here's another way to look at what might be best for a child. So.
Am I seeing any hands?
Are we good?
Do we have time for one quick story? Okay, one quick story. In context of what you just said, tell the story about why you make sure your kids develop a sense of responsibility. So the way you're doing it is you got
chickens. Oh, our chickens. Sorry. Well, I got here all delusional yesterday because I'd gotten up at 2 a.m. to the sound of raccoons chasing my chickens across the yard. I was out there with a broom, you know. But we were just talking about raising kids and how hard it is and how you're trying to teach them to be responsible. And, you know, I was the kid who worked 6 days a week when I went to Stanford and saved my tips in tequila bottles and paid the bursar's office in cash. They thought I was doing something much more illegal, I'm sure. So I've always had this incredible work ethic, and then, you know, my husband and I have done very well, and my daughter's not gonna have to start working when she's 13, right? And so you're just constantly trying to think about ways to raise responsible, hardworking kids. And so part of it was my daughter really wanted chickens, and I said, absolutely, and you're gonna have to do it all. So she sets her alarm every morning. She's out there feeding her chickens and watering and cleaning the coop all before school. It's like we live on a farm, you know, even though we're in Monterey, but it's been good for her.
Well, there's a real community value for chickens in Traverse City, so you're in good
company. Okay, well, that's great.
Vanessa, thank you ever so much.
Thank
this
you
has been
all.
Lovely. And
thank you.
Thank you.